Major funding for the Woodwright Shop is provided by...
When the unexpected happens, State Farm has the tools to get you to a better state. Proud sponsor of the Woodwright Shop.
Again, welcome back to the Woodwright Shop. I'm Roy Underhill, so glad you can be with me again today because we have our good friend with us, master chair maker, master teacher, and innovator in hand tools, Brian Boggs. Brian, great to see you here.
That's good to be here, Roy.
All right, and great to see you working on this shaving horse of your own design.
That's
innovation,
right.
Taking the country by storm. So we're going to take a look at your horse and some of the tools that you've been working on. But Brian, I wonder if we could start with your chairs, because that's what you're about, chair making.
Sure can.
All right, let's take a peek. In fact, can we take a look at this one, the oak one?
Let's do.
All right. It's like my dog running to me to greet me when I get home. I love the energy of this chair here. Well, tell me about it now.
So this was inspired by some early chairs that I was starting to do, very similar to John Alexander's. And then over the years, I started playing with the design and just sort of, in my view now, looking back, sort of trying to get a sense of what this chair was trying to become. Mm. It was the point of this chair is to create comfort, stability, and to kind of communicate with the person who's buying it, owning it, sitting it, enjoying it, what this process is about.
It's astounding. I understand all the things you're saying, but you know, it's all embodied in here in a silent statement. It's just incredible.
If you feel it, you don't have to think about it.
So here we go. Again, oak, steam bent here on the back, that back shaft.
That's right. The splay to help stabilize the base so it won't fall over. And then the bend up here, this is to follow your backbone. Each curve of the slat is slightly different, corresponding to that part of your back.
Oh my gosh. And then, of course, it's not just the back that's involved. We also have another part of the mounting stuff.
That's right. It's the inner bark of the hickory tree, and I've developed a process that allows me to get a very uniform splint. And then in weaving, each one of these, I taper side to side so it fits this tapered seat.
And I see that back here. You see that the pieces are narrower here at the back than they are down at the front. So they kind of splay out a little bit. So you don't have to add in those floating sections down on the sides like a lot of folks have to do.
Yes, it is not so much a labor-saving device as a way of getting these lines to be continuous even out to the end.
Oh gosh, it's a marvelous, marvelous piece. I love the white oak too.
It's one of my favorites.
Yeah, that's the wood. All right, but we got to move on. We've got another one here. This one's a rocking chair in cherry.
That's right. Wild black cherry.
This is beautiful.
And this is also steam bent. The slats each bent differently to that part of your back. And if you look at this curve here, this is just to invite the sitter. But each line is important. This follows your back line. This cutaway here is the angle of your elbow when you're holding a baby or reading a book.
Yeah.
This line here is your knuckle line when you're reaching around to feel the cuts I've left with the draw knife for the fingertips to enjoy. Every detail has at least a couple of purposes. And then the finish, while it's smooth, if you're touching it, you can feel the interesting facets of
texture,
the spoke shape.
Yeah, I can feel it as working my way around. So this is not sanded or anything.
No, and you can see heavy draw knife cuts here. Even though they're faceted, they're very slick.
Oh gosh, American cherry. What a wonderful bend. Again, steam bent with that wonderful sinuous curve in there. I love it. Now you have brought out in this one here. This is a sitting chair with a wonderful design, but look what, got to look at this right here. This is cherry again as well.
This is quarter sawn cherry, and all of the parts in the back are quarter sawn, so that it lines the medullary rays up with the long grain of the opposite part. This is about stability.
Oh man, well you can see the way that fleck in there is just really brought out.
From the medullary rays.
Just astounding. Mm-hmm. Right, and it's neat in this design, the splats go all the way down to this low back rail. What were you working on with this chair?
Well, there's a couple of things here. I wanted more length to create a more flexible back slat for more comfort. But the long line accentuates the curves in the back. You see more of this curve.
And more spring, too,
I guess. It's a little more inviting. And it just exaggerates the whole point of that back, which is to invite you in.
And this is very sculptural work here.
Very sculptural, massive joints here, which give me the strength that allow me to eliminate pieces below here. So this is all open for a more simple look than I can have with my ladder backs.
So it's kind of a little bit of the late Sam Maloof's inspiration.
Definitely some Maloof inspiration there, although the joinery is very different. The idea of sculpting that fluid curve around there comes from being around his work.
Oh, gosh, wonderful. So again, Cherry, and your designs are becoming more and more individual, more Brian Boggs, less folk chairs. But here's something you have come to where a lot of people begin. This is a beautiful little piece
here. Actually, the original designs that I was playing with, it's again inspired by John Alexander's work. This is very close to the early Appalachian chairs. Soft maple for the legs, red maple, hickory for the slats and rungs. That's an ideal combination that works as the legs, which are damp at assembly time, shrink and grab that hickory.
And they,
the hickory swells and locks inside that leg. And you've got a joint that's very, very tight and that will last for generations without depending on the glue.
So, again, just using the shrinkage of the wood to hold this thing together.
That's right.
That's a differential shrinkage, we should say, I guess, the dry and the wet.
That's right. Shrinkage of the leg, swelling of the rung.
And the right kinds of wood in the right place. And this is something you say apprentices, this is your apprentice chair?
That's right. I brought it back to teach the beginnings of chair making the way I learned. I wanted my apprentices to have something that was a little bit simpler to start out on.
Well, good stuff. And now I want to get into this technique you do to make the pieces a little bit. And of course, that's here on your shaving horse. And with all the attention you've paid to chairs, you lavished that attention on your design of the shaving horse.
Well, This was an inspiration from the early shaving horse like this and a very persistent backache.
Oh, my God.
So I did a lot of study while being down with a bad back.
So you got a leather
and came up with a tilted seat to help rotate my pelvis.
Yeah.
It holds me forward. It rotates my pelvis, which restores my lumbar curve, keeping my knees below my pelvis, keeps my back a little bit more open. And because the seat is tilted, part of my weight is borne by my feet. Resting on the foot bar, my weight then transfers to clamping force. So in the relaxed position, this piece is clamped in.
So you're harnessing your own gravity with this design.
Right. That's right. And so it's work to open up, but very little work relaxing to hold.
I like that. And I like the, again, this is angled at you with a rotating leather head right there.
That's right. So if the piece is different shape, this will follow that shape. This holds it easily. So the pull here is just a matter of relax and swing my hands toward me. It's going to cut. So with the least amount of effort for my body to hold myself in position or hold the work, I can focus on just making
that
cut.
That's what it's about. It's really focusing on the wood, so it's telling you what it wants to do all the time.
Putting my energy to work where I need it to be.
All right, now let's see the adjustment part. That's what's really wonderful, I think, with this one as well. The
this actually
ratchet action
helps the pivot power by keeping this in the maximum height position. It allows me to have maximum leverage here. So I wanted this to be very easily adjustable so that I wouldn't wait until I absolutely had to adjust it. I can adjust it with a thought or even without thinking.
That's wonderful. Again, very kind of snubbed on the back there, and you say that helps you with a curved piece.
That's right. If I have a piece like this running through here, it's not going to hit anything out there. And I'm putting a finish on with these tools, so I don't want to dent the part.
Well, here I am just on this old splitter. My old horse here is looking pretty lame beside it, but this is where it came from, and you're moving the tradition forward. The tradition never stopped, so why should it stop now? Carry it on.
Right. I wanted to immerse myself in the old tradition to understand it, but then build from there to bring it about as far as I can.
I'm still working with hand tools.
That's right.
I got to do it. All right. Now, I tell you what, I'm going to get you a little draw knife technique, but let me split you a fresh piece, and we'll take a spindle through. So I'm going to bust a piece of hickory right here, and I got my fro and my maul, and does this look like big enough? Well, it's almost
That'll
big enough for
fine.
A spindle.
All Nobody's right. measuring.
All right. There's a piece of nice, Alec Bizarre gave me this piece here, nice piece of hickory. So I got that. pop that open, he said. And all right, now when you split this, of course, you're capturing the strength of the grain in the piece, but it also, you say it makes, you like that one better?
Mm-hmm.
All right, you also say that makes it easier to work. How is that?
Well, because I'm cutting with the grain. I'm going with the flow of the piece. I'm not fighting the grain. Although this is fairly dry, it's a little bit harder. One of the things that's nice about splitting stock too is you're working the wood while it's green. It's so much easier to cut. It takes a lot less manual force.
And are you able to still get as good a finish on the wood when it's green? I mean, or do you let it dry as you get closer to spoke shaves and stuff like that?
I don't worry about getting a finish on it when it's green. I try to get it close to shape while it's green.
Okay.
To get the bulk of the work done while it's easy. I find I get a better finish when it's dry, but also it's going to take a while to dry. I'm going to be handling it. I don't want to have to worry about scratching the finish.
I see.
So I'll wait till the very last minute to put the finish on, the finish cuts
on. Pretty darn dry.
Yeah, it's pretty dry, but because I'm cutting with the grain, even hickory isn't bad to work. What makes it harder to work is, now this is a little bit tearing here, but it's areas like this where I'm fighting the grain and in hardwood that make it doubly difficult to work with.
All right. Well, I'd say, you know, what you're working with is also making a difference. Can we take a look at your draw knife here? Because I know you innovate a lot with tools, but this is an old draw knife.
I just haven't had any complaints with this. I mean, it seems like
it
a tool that's so well developed. Yeah. So perfectly in tune with the way a person is built and the way a person works with this, it's just like an extension of my hands. It just feels so nice.
I'm working with it here to see what kind of bevel you have. You have a bevel on the backside, so instead of this being flat, that's slightly rounded.
It's slightly rounded because even in a straight cut, I'm coming into the wood and then turning to go straight.
Okay.
So that swoop at the beginning of the cut has to be made by whatever part of the draw knife is down.
Ah!
So that means that whatever is down, whether it's the bevel or the back, has to have at least that much curve or I'll grab here at the bottom.
You've got to have that rocker control a little bit,
am I right?
Okay. And this is, again, has that steel. This is wonderful. I know you work with new steels, but you like this? This is laminated. It has the hard old carbon steel there and the wrought iron body, the two types of metal.
There's a couple of things going on here. The fact that it's a hard steel here and a soft steel back here allows me to have soft metal here and I can adjust the handles however I want.
Oh, just bend them.
Just bend them cold. The other thing is because this was hammered together, a lot of people believe that that makes a tougher blade.
Work hardens it maybe a little bit.
I've been told that it breaks up or makes the grain a little bit finer. That's something I barely grasp an understanding of, but anyway, it makes sense to me.
I'm glad there's something. Well, listen, I want you to watch me here a little bit, and maybe you can explain something to me, because I have watched you, and of course, I've worked by myself working, holding the draw knife, as I'm doing here, with a diagonal cut. And, you know, to my mind, this is like, instead of walking straight up a hill, you are walking up the side of a hill diagonally. So, am I right? This is reducing the effective bevel?
It's reducing the angle because that angle is going more parallel to the grain. Of course, if you were going dead straight to the grain, you'd have a zero angle. The more you angle perpendicular to the blade, the higher the angle.
Ah.
That's only part of what's helping your control here. When you're pulling straight into the cut like that, you're rocking on a very tiny line just behind the blade. Nothing else is touching.
Right.
When you're skewing like you were before, you're increasing the length of support in the direction you're pulling.
And I can feel it digging in when I did that. When I did that, it was kind of chattering and digging in. When I do it this way, I've lengthened the wheelbase there.
And look where your hands are. Yeah. You've got one hand well in front of the other instead of both of them being on the same line.
Plane like that. All right.
Right. So you're using your hands like this to stabilize the cut. So you've got a lot more stability, so it's easier to hold a consistent chip. With that type of cut. The other thing is you're throwing the chip to the side.
Yeah,
it's kind of like converting a straight cut to a cross grain cut. Of course, you make the cool little curly chips.
With a curly cue. But again, it's more of a skew cut with the grain. So instead of digging in, it's kind of being worked from the sides. You're kind of tricking the grain.
Wood is less likely to split when you're throwing that chip off to the side.
All right. Well, that answers a few. Yeah, I knew it worked, but I didn't know why. All right, so let's go through this. Let me see you bring that down now. So you have a process,
okay, so
I think,
of that's right.
Traditional square.
I'm going to square this up a little bit, okay. Even if I'm going to go to a round.
I'll let you work at full speed here for a second.
I like to work it square first.
All right.
And this end's all beat up, so I'm not going to worry about that
all
too
right.
much.
All right.
And then I would make an octagon. That's just so that I'm taking initially four planes down.
All right.
And it's faster because I'm only working four planes, but it also gives me a better view of the shape of the piece, having only four corners to look at. Mm. Now it's maintaining corners, and with an octagon, I'm still working fairly efficiently because I'm only working four more sides.
Uh-huh.
Now, when I get into a cut like this, I stop working with the draw knife.
I see that knot, yeah.
That's tearing. That's the grain dropping down. So at this point, I would start using my spoke shaves.
All right. Do you want to continue on that piece or go to
this is fine. This is a perfect
really?
Piece
okay.
because
oh,
this
okay.
is an example of why you would stop using the draw knife
all right.
and how a tool like this will help control.
And this is very much like the old spoke shaves, the old wooden ones that I enjoy using, that flat blade down there held by tangs, so your angle of it's like having a knife right on the wood. I mean, that's what it is.
It is basically works like a draw knife, and this throat adjustment helps control the depth of cut. It's like a draw knife with a depth
with
of
a depth gauge. On.
That's
yeah.
right, all exactly. Right. So that helps keep the blade from digging down in that tear.
But you're again working kind of diagonally there.
I'm working diagonally because with this, I'm resting mostly on the blade.
Oh, okay.
So with that diagonal cut, it helps stabilize the cut.
Oh, but and this, what is this, Osage orange?
Osage orange. It's handmade here in North Carolina. Beautiful little tool.
Beautiful, yeah.
With this low angle, too, this is a great tool for end grain.
Okay. Wow. All right, so you can work that through.
So I would work down to a certain point. But even with this tool, it doesn't have the best chip control.
Now, how about this one now?
This one's got everything.
Oh, really? This is your own design now.
Yeah. Right. Okay, so I'm a little biased.
Yeah, this is being manufactured for you, but this is great and being sold by other folks. But
That's right.
What makes it work? All right.
So it's balanced, so it's got the handles in line with the blade, so whether I'm pulling or turning it around and pushing, it works just fine. Now, this blade is coming in, and the chip breaker is all the way up to the edge. So
it's this cap here that holds it all down with these two screws. That's really a chip breaker right down by the edge.
And it's turning that chip over instead of lifting that chip up. It's using the chip itself to hold the wood down ahead
push
of the cut so it doesn't lift up, which is what causes this tearing.
All right.
So it'll take a while because that's a deep tear right there. But can see it's no longer, it's not continuing to tear.
Right.
It's cleaning that up.
And the diagonal helps a little through that, too?
I skew with everything that I can, whether it's a plane or a shave, for all the reasons I described with your draw knife. It stabilizes the cut, it cuts more easily, and it throws that chip to the side.
This is mighty fun.
Now, this is almost gone now. I have almost to the bottom of that.
Now, I got to see this one now. This
is one I just made all by hand. This is out of steel bar stock.
Just made
with a hacksaw.
So you just cut that out and filed it and ground it?
I wanted a good spoke shave, and I couldn't buy one, so I had to invent one.
Just make one. All right.
So this actually works very well, even though I'm missing a screw and I've got a wood plug in there.
So it's got a concave bottom, so it matches greater the contour that you're aiming for.
It'll more efficiently shape something round because it takes fewer cuts to do it. Really? The whole idea with having the right tool is to cut with the fewest strokes needed to get the job finished. So this does basically the same thing as that flat one, only with the round or the curved edge, I'll more efficiently shape this round.
Now you've got one here also in brass. Is that the same thing?
Not quite. This one was pretty good. Mm-hmm. I liked it. It worked well, but the balance didn't feel right when I set it on the wood. It felt like it was flopping onto the wood. And it didn't work the same.
I can see this.
Pushing and pulling. With this one, I can hold it any way I want to. Pulling, I can also push it, and it cuts the same. I can use it one-handed pulling, one-handed pushing, and it's got good action.
Yeah, I mean, like a knife slinger there.
I can also roll into it.
Just working with one hand around
the
end grain. All right, now.
One of the things I do with it, if I want to chamfer that edge, I can just hook that and roll.
So let's see, work that edge there. All right, so you got that in one hand.
And I would roll it down my leg.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, just like this.
Oh, man.
Almost like a lap lathe.
Ah.
And it makes a perfect chamfer.
That's beautiful. Look at that. All right. Well, if that weren't enough, you've still got another one here. This one here, which really was astounding to me, in that it seems to have a wooden blade. Now, this is, and you put the iron in upside down. What are you thinking here? This is an amazing
tool. I'm
thinking
chip control.
Okay.
And just like with the other one where I've got that chip breaker right down near the edge to turn that chip over quickly, this one, the whole tool, the whole blade is the chip breaker. And then I've bent that edge forward just like this model here.
Okay, now here we go, one in soft metal. So we're seeing the orientation, the bevel, instead of being like this in the previous one, is turned over like this, and you've got, you see a little bit of a hook right there, that little bright line is the turned edge, am I right? Just
that's
like
right.
on a cabinet
and
scraper.
So that is
and
the
that's
blade.
What cuts, that turned edge.
And then the body of this bevel here becomes the chip breaker, which turns the chip over as soon as it is cut by that burr, which is the blade.
Man. And I've seen it work. Let's see.
And so with this one, I can cut just about anything, and it makes a more crumpled chip.
Now do that slowly. Do that. So I got to just see
you
that slowly.
You can see that chip coming out of there like crepe paper, but it leaves a polished surface over any knot or anything that would tear otherwise. So the idea is to be able to think about the shape of the piece and let the tool do the work.
I'm getting lost in this, you know, just marveling in all the tools, but the whole object of this is so you can pay attention to the wood.
That's right.
Not to
want the tools to do the work so I can think about executing the form that I've envisioned for this design.
Oh, man. All right. Now, the wood never goes away, though. Like, if we take a look at that little bit right there, your apprentice chair. I'm going to see that one. Because this, one of the things you mentioned, John Alexander, and the work he did in studying the orientation of the grain and really thinking this out more than the old guys did. I don't know that they did this so much, but tell me what you got with the grain.
Well, I had the luxury of being able to read books that were written more recently and a lot of scientific study about wood movement. And this is a way, the green wood chair making is a way of using wood movement to best advantage. So here I've got the growth rings going around this way. Around this way in the back. So they go around the chair.
In the posts. So this just is just like
they
the
did
tree.
In the tree. Mm-hmm. So it puts the tree back together and keeps the movement as the piece shrinks and swells. And it does that every time the weather changes.
Right.
The shrinking and swelling is even on both rungs.
Okay, so you've evened it out. One's not getting more stressed than the other. What about the orientation in these pieces here?
These pieces are super dry at assembly time. And I've oriented them with the medullary rays vertically.
Let me see, I've got a piece here. Because we're talking about medullary rays. This might be the best one to a piece of oak, because oak has incredible medullary
rays. You can really see it there. So this would be...
Let me get that right there. So this is the way we're oriented. In the tree, am I right there with
That's
the
right.
bark to the outside? And you can see, I think, right there, that wonderful shiny stuff.
That's a ray,
and those are cells that go this way, in and out, like the spokes of a wheel on the tree, and that keeps the wood from shrinking as much in this direction.
Right.
So it doesn't shrink as much this way. It shrinks the most this way, and almost none at all in this direction.
Exactly.
So by so if we orient this like that.
That's the way
the rungs
are.
And we're talking about the rungs.
So that the medullary rays now, shown on the end of this, are in line with the most stable orientation of the leg. And that diminishes the stress in this joint in the weather changes.
Oh,
humidity changes alone can destroy a joint if you don't pay attention to that.
Oh, man. Well, speaking of destroying, I want to look at, you know, people are selling off rainforests down south. I'm going to take just a second here. We've got about a minute to look at another piece here that I want to see, and I think this is maybe the most important piece of all here. This is you and the Greenwood Trust, is that right, the Greenwood folks?
Greenwood is an organization that I helped found with Scott Landis and Curtis Buchanan about 15 years ago, and Greenwood's mission is to help those in and around rainforests work to maintain and support a healthy forest system. Mm. It's about sustainable forest management, and we teach them how to add value to those woods so that they can make a living doing that.
So they don't have to sell the whole, you know, clear cut this forest to some manufacturer off somewhere and denude their land. They can actually take one tree and work it right there and make furniture to sell.
They can use the forest to support themselves.
Yeah. All right. Well, that, of course, keeps, and we say to support themselves, it supports us as well. Exactly. These are the lungs of the world. So you are saving the world through woodworking, you and the Greenwood guys.
One tree at a time.
Oh, man. What kind of wood is this right here?
This is Tornillo Rojo. Excuse me. This is Tornillo Amarillo. We also work with Tornillo Rojo. This is yellow screw is what the English
yellow
translation.
Yellow screw?
That's right, because the grain goes around the tree like a screw thread.
Oh, my gosh.
And it makes it, that and the fact that it's very abrasive, make it a very difficult wood to work with.
That's why it's adds there.
That's why it's adds across the grain.
Okay. Well, Brian Boggs, thank you so much for joining us and for the work you're doing. You've just added so much to this wonderful craft. I appreciate it so much. And thank you for joining me. This is Roy Underhill here in the Woodwright Shop. We'll see you next time. So long.
Learn more about the Woodwright Shop and traditional woodworking on our website. You can find us online at pbs.org. Major funding for the Woodwright Shop is provided by
when the unexpected happens, State Farm has the tools to get you to a better state. Proud sponsor of the Woodwright Shop.
Be more. PBS.
Roy Underhill is the author of The Woodwright's Guide, Working Wood with Wedge and Edge, as well as other books on traditional woodworking, all published by the University of North Carolina Press and available in bookstores and libraries.